Okay, yeah. You got to go, Denny. Jason Statham is here.
Yeah.
Bet you he likes Spider-Man a lot.
All right, Denny.
Thank you.
Where do you want me to sit?
In your office?
Where's Jason going to sit if I'm here?
You go sit in your office, Dennis. Jason Statham's here.
Hi, Dennis. How are you, buddy? How you been?
Dennis is out of here.
Where should I sit?
Right where Dennis was sitting.
Right there.
Yeah.
You could turn down the Barry Manilow.
We were just listening to some Barry Manilow based on the shocking news of his coming out.
He came out as gay. I was shocked, Barry Manilow. I had no idea.
I had no idea.
Nothing would have indicated it. I mean, for 40 years maybe, there's been a few little sneaking suspicions.
Here and there, but not really.
Here and there. Nothing. No dead giveaways.
No.
I'm always happy for people when they come out. Like, yeah, good for you. But it's sad that they have to wait so long. Like,
what is the dead giveaway, by the way?
Every song he's ever sung.
Yeah.
I think, I don't know what it is. You know what? I don't know. What makes you know somebody is, I don't know. You just kind of feel like,
Yeah. You just kind of know.
You just know.
Like Liberace. Like it wasn't, but I think Barry Manilow, like that Liberace time period, I guess it was a thing where you did have to stay in the closet for your fan base. Because that's what Barry Manilow said.
Because women liked you.
He was worried about his fan base. But like, I'm sure it's probably been 20 years at least that Barry Manilow could have easily just come out and not lost a single fan.
Well, you're afraid that the women's fantasy of you, like you're a rugged guy, Jason, the idea of you, that would probably kill a lot of female fans for you. They'd be like, fuck, this is the guy that
you think so?
Yeah.
I don't know.
The fans would still like his work, but they would probably go, like, oh.
I don't know.
No comment.
Well, listen. Fast 8 is coming out.
Yeah, it's coming out. Yeah.
Are you excited about this?
Yeah. I mean, it's another fucking movie, right?
Yeah.
That's the best promo. By the way, if you do the Tonight Show, please say that to Jimmy Fallon.
Can we swear on it?
Yeah. Absolutely. But that's a great promotion. It's another fucking movie.
It's another
movie,
fucking movie, right? Everybody's like, yeah, I'll go see another fucking movie. Sure.
Have you in your career? I'm sure you have, and you like. I know this franchise you love. Have you ever in your career had to promote something that you didn't love, and you got to do it? You don't even have to say what the movie was.
Yeah, plenty of fucking times.
Oh, you haven't? Okay.
Well, look, the point is, it's very hard to be open and frank about the ongoings or whatever. Let's say you work with a director who's a bit of an idiot, you don't get on, you don't really think he's that clever or whatever. It's very difficult to say that because it's just negativity. So it's better, if you've got my mum always used to say, if you've got nothing good to say, don't say anything at all.
Yes, and I think my mother wrote that down because she hated me.
So in a way, it's better to not get into that world because you just sound like you're a bit of a negative chap. And, not always. In all kinds of business everywhere, I think people, you get the rough with the smooth. Some movies are the best, smoothest ride, and you can have the best fun, and they become a real purpose in your memory. And you have you look back with great fondness on those times. And others, you just can't wait to get the hell out of there. And that's just nature of the business, no matter what you're doing.
But you got to be beyond getting yelled at, though. Like, you're Jason Statham. Like when you're newer, a director probably has to talk to you a certain way.
About even getting yelled at. I mean, you just really want, you want to work with smart people, and smart people make you relax and you can have a good time. But if people are doing stupid things in front of your nose, then it's very hard to say, this is a good day at work.
Right. But, and you have to bite your tongue the whole time or let him know he's being a fucking idiot.
Well, that's the usual thing. It's hard to say. You have to really be a good politician in what you do and how you behave. Otherwise, you'd end up in punch-ups every day.
You don't want a negative vibe on the set, even if they can't fire you because you're you. You still don't want that feeling on the set like, oh, fucking Jason's difficult. Like, you want it to be smooth. So how will you tell somebody, if this is a decision a director's making that you don't like, you might want to voice your opinion. Will you take them aside and go, maybe we could try it? Will you be a diplomat about it?
Yeah, of course, because you don't want to be, you want to try and help people to help. You want to, help me help you, I think that's the idea. You want to try and until there's only so many times that you can really go there, but you want to try and be as helpful as possible. I think the best idea, you just want to get the job done. Some days you really have to be smart about how you handle things with certain people.
How many times will you go to somebody with a suggestion or being like, look, I really think we should do it this way, and not be listened to before you just snap? And be like, what are we doing?
You know, it's some people, you just, I don't know, it's some people have a, I mean, the thing with a director, they have to have a vision, right? And it's sometimes not in line with what the script is or your perception of what the script is. There's a lot of moving parts with a script, with a movie, as a finished movie. You know, you've got the vision of what you might anticipate it to be can be completely different by the time it's finished. And you have to accept that. I mean, at the end of the day, we shouldn't be moaning because we're hired actors. You come in, you get paid, shut your mouth, do your work and go home. It should be a little bit of that, but sometimes you want to try and get involved and you want to try and collaborate and get things done and try and, you know, help with the creativity. And sometimes you can do that. And
you also want it to be the best.
There's no clear-cut line about you being an actor, come in, say these lines and then go home, or, you know, come in and collaborate and let's work this out and do things and, you know, make the best of it.
Do you ever want to, like, because, you know, you're a guy who does fast, high-action movies. Do you ever, like, get offered parts, like, where you play something totally different? Like, you know what I mean? Like, you're a concerned father and you're in a divorce and, like, it's a real soft role and you just don't want to do
it. Whose daughter got kidnapped and now he must save her.
No, that would probably be the same as this. No, but I mean something that's so out of the box for you. Yeah, do you get offered that stuff?
Look, mathematician that's going through a bitter divorce or something. No, I don't get offered those.
You know. Would you want to do one or no?
Not really. You know, no. I mean, I only want to do things that I think I could do a good job at, and I think I'll be no good at that.
Really?
No, I just, you know, I'm not an actor, really. I mean, I used to, you know, work jewellery and pinch jewellery on the streets.
Did some modelling.
You're right. You know, as a sportsman for years. I'm not really some thespian that can adopt and chameleon himself into different roles. I just got into this by, you know, being at the right place at the right time. I was, you know, working in the street, selling jewellery, and I got plucked from obscurity into the movie industry. So it's not like I spent years honing how to do different accents or pretending how, you know, working on my craft, whatever it is. You know, that stupid line, you know, that doesn't apply to me. So I accept what I'm good at, or if I'm, well, I might not be good at any of it, but I accept what I feel that I'm confident at and just try and go with the flow in that direction, you know?
Well, being confident at it and comfortable, I think that's the biggest part of it. And it's like, it's just relaxing for you. You're not intimidated by any of it. And I think that's why you are good at what you do.
Yeah, just, I mean, a lot of the characters I play are, you know, pretty similar in some ways. You know, I get a lot of the physical roles because I can do all that. So there's an authenticity with that. So I tend to stick to it, you know, and it's, you know, I try and do things that aren't always like bashing people up. I mean, I've done a couple of movies that, I played a bit of a drunk and sort of homeless guy once. It was a movie called Hummingbird. It was a good stretch for me to do something that wasn't necessarily playing the hero, because the hero is, you know, something that I've done a lot of, you know, with Expendables and Transporter 1 and 2 and 3 and all those things where you have this indestructible sort of physical side. So I've done a couple of things, but it's hard. You have to really wait and choose something that really is of good quality, because just to do something different. Actually, no, I did a comedy recently with Paul Feig and Melissa McCarthy, and that was one of the best laughs I've ever had.
What was the movie?
It was called Spy.
It's a big movie, yeah.
Oh, yes, that's right.
Yeah, yep. And that, to me, you know, that was a breakaway from what I normally do. So, I really enjoyed that, and it's you know, now and again something comes your way and you go, yeah, I'll give that a go. Yeah, but it's not like I'm searching for
it. Right.
Your story is exactly what the guy from Captain Phillips thought was going to happen to him, the Somalian guy who's like, yeah, I got plucked from obscurity too, and now I'm in the movies. And they're like, no, you're in a movie. This doesn't keep going after this.
Yeah, I met him. He was a really nice chap. I met him when a couple of years ago, 3 years ago.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, and
he got nominated for that.
Yeah, he got nominated, yeah.
That's almost a curse, though. Like, not that you can't have a good career, but if you get nominated or you win, like Timothy Hutton won for Ordinary People.
Right in the beginning.
For supporting actor, really young. Yeah, sometimes if you win too soon, it has a, even though he's always worked and he has a great career, but it jinxes you a little bit, I think, on some level.
Yeah.
If you win,
I've got
too
no worries
early.
About that. I don't panic about the jinxing.
Do you go to the Oscars?
No. No.
Could you? I'm a member
of the Academy.
But you've never gone?
We never get invited.
Do you have guys at home that came from where you came from that are like, especially when you first started, that were like, yeah, I'm going to do that too. Like, if you could just get plucked off the street, like, I'm going to be an actor. Right now, I'm selling jewelry, and I'm waiting to become an actor.
Yeah, why you and not me? It's literally that in some ways. Because I've got a lot of people that are funny and you could put them in a movie, no problem. You get the right director, you get the right script, you get a, you know, I think anyone can act, really. I just think you need a guy that can cut and edit around certain things that you do. And I think, you know, I've seen people do put performances together in the edit room that are really, really good. And on the set, you just go, Jesus Christ, this person doesn't know what they're doing.
Yeah, all of my work, actually. What they do is every scene I'm in, they just shoot me from the back and they just, you know, shoot around me.
Isn't it refreshing, though, to hear an actor come in and go, like, it's really not a difficult thing to do? It's not.
It's not that hard, and I've watched people suck.
If someone gives you something funny to say, You can probably sound really funny and cool or whatever, you know.
Right.
Yeah. So.
So you've done stuff with people. You've seen people on the set where you're like, ugh, boy, that's gonna be a rough one to fix. And then they fix it.
Yeah.
What happened with The Rock on the set? Because while they were filming, The Rock goes off on Instagram while they're filming this movie, Fate of the Furious, which is in theaters next Friday, and he just kind of like vaguely started talking about people that he was working with on the set of this movie, which was really weird and out of character for The Rock to kind of go on a weird social media rant about some unnamed person or whatever.
You know, I'm really good with The Rock and what he does and what he experiences is his own thing. And a lot of the time when we're working, you come in, you do your thing, and you get in your car and you go home. So a lot of the time I'm not working when Vin's there or I'm not working when Tyrese is there. Everyone's got their own thing. So if stuff happens on set and you're not privy to what was going on, you just keep your nose out of it.
So you like look
you
at
leave
it,
them to
like
it.
You hear that story and be like, oh boy, like that's nothing to do with me. I'm not even going to ask.
Yeah, I don't get into any of that. It's not my business and I don't want to make it my business.
Right, right. The last thing you want to do is know. Because then now you're a part of this ridiculous story.
Then you're
story.
A part of it, yeah, and you can answer your questions then, can't I?
But now you can just come in and go, it's another fucking movie.
Yeah, what do I know? How is it? I think it was the last Fast and the Furious movie, or the one before that. I think it was the last one, though, when you and The Rock had, like, this ridiculous fight scene in the office where you were shattering glass and everything.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. How was it to take The Rock bottom? Because it was he did his wrestling move to you through a coffee table in the movie.
Yeah, he's so cool to do things, to do an action sequence with because he's such a physical sort of expert in what he does. You know, he moves fluidly. He's got great sort of judgment of time and space. So he's not going to whack you in the head by mistake, which is a godsend.
That happens.
Right? You don't want to. Yeah, people make mistakes. If you're not really, if you haven't got sort of a good concept of your own sort of
body and space.
If you're, you know, if you're swinging hard with adrenaline, you know, you're trying to miss each other, but carefully miss each other.
Right.
And if you're not, you know, accurate in that sense, you can really make a mistake. And if he makes a mistake and you're on the receiving end of it, then it's straight down to hospital. So he's the opposite of that. I mean, he's extremely precise and he's just so relaxed and he's just a diamond to work with. You know, he's a 10 out of 10.
I'm watching the scene now. It's really well done. When you do a fight scene like that, like you said, you got to miss each other's face by a quarter inch. Are you throwing five or six punches and then they change the camera, or are you throwing literally one and they're shooting and then they're piecing it all together?
Well, they shoot from different angles, and you shoot it as a, like, it'll be five, six moves, and then they'll capture it from different angles. And usually we try and use it in one camera, try and make it good for one camera, or two, at least the coverage on two. But sometimes, you know, how they edit these things is, again, you're at the mercy of the director and how they see it. I mean, sometimes we'll shoot a sequence, and it's a point of frustration sometimes, because if you try and fight several guys or, you know, several opponents, and you want one particular angle and you want to capture it in a single take, you'll have the camera sort of moving back with you. And it really sort of puts the audience into that moment. And I think sometimes nowadays you can get there's so many cuts that it kind of takes you out of it. And, you know, in a way they can they kind of ruin the sort of flow of it and the real. I mean, if you look at some of the old Bruce Lee movies or Jackie Chan or Jet Li, they'll leave the camera, a single camera, on these chaps for quite a long time, and you get a real sense of them physically performing this fight. And I think a lot of the time now, it's what you see in Hollywood. They cut it and they mess it up to some degree. And I think that's a lot of the time with people that, you know, can't do three or four moves without fucking it up.
Oh, and they're just right. We have the technology now to piece this together.
So you can make your grandma look good in a fight scene by, you know, the expertise of editing.
I also think it's a part of it. It moves faster too. They feel everybody likes things to move very quickly now.
And
so
it looks
when
like
they cut it,
a video game.
Yeah, yeah. Pow, pow. It just boom. There's very little setups in between these. You're right. It's just moving.
Yeah,
quickly.
It's almost like a style that has been. It's like a, you know, video high. They speed ramp certain things, so they make it that looks a little unrealistic for some, you know, science fiction movies and stuff like that. I think, you know, The Matrix, and trying to reference a couple of pictures, I think it looks really good and can look really impressive where they speed ramp it and then they go extreme slow motion and they get a great effect with it. So I think it's all about the purpose and the type of movie, whether it's good to be used. I think it's really important what kind of film it is.
Yeah, I mean, one of the like best fight scenes ever is that fight scene in They Live, and that's like a long, like 15-minute fight scene, and so many of the takes are really just long. And so it feels like you're actually, you can actually get lost in it. It's not this thing that you're like, and you kind of develop this sense of like, okay, this isn't real, this is something else. When the takes are long and you're watching these two guys fight, I think it's easier to get lost in the fact that it's real.
Yeah, and you know, there's one thing for sure. If it's a long take, these guys, you have to be able to perform it. So, you know, you can't hide behind sort of stuntmen and quick editing. So if you people like Tony Jaa, he's a Thai fighter that basically does, you know, do you ever see a movie called On Back?
No.
Again, he did a really long take. I think it was like a 7-minute fight sequence that went up a staircase, up a second floor, 3, 4, 5, 6 floors. And I think he fights about, you know, 50, 60 guys. And I can't imagine how many times he'd done that. But to get it all sort of inch perfect is pretty outstanding to do that in today's world.
That's why you're better off being in a John Woo movie, because you get to shoot everybody. That's the easy. All you got to do is point guns and shoot.
You just point a gun, yeah.
Did you ever watch those old John Woo films? Yeah. Those are where Tarantino said he got a lot of his ideas and the double gun. Those are the best movies, man. There's so much great violence in them.
Yeah, dude, superb.
Is this, I doubt it, but is this, do we know if this is the last Fast and Furious movie? It's called The Fate of the Furious. But it's
seems like an end.
It's the eighth
film.
But people kind of thought the last one was going to be the end because of Paul Walker, and they figured out how to do it. They figured out how to bring the franchise back, obviously. So I've in my mind, if people are still going to see these movies, just do them forever, right? Who cares? Like, hey, just keep doing them.
It's like, you know, the audience demands whether you do another or not, right? I mean, if there's $1 billion that's going through the cash register, there's another one coming.
Yeah, yeah. so this will be the last one. If it doesn't sell, if it sells tickets, we got more.
Yeah, and you know, the appetite is what creates the writers and everybody to get inspired and go, you know what, maybe that guy didn't. And all of a sudden, you've got a great script.
I don't know what it is about these movies, because I don't even like superhero movies anymore. Like, I get tired of stuff, but I just keep going back to these Fast and Furious movies. I watch all of them, like, over and over. Like, I think they're awesome.
Have you gotten hurt doing any of these? Any of these fight scenes? Have you ever gotten clipped?
You always get clipped, yeah. I mean, usually you end up going in with a little injury anyway. By virtue of what I've done over the years, I've always getting a few things stacked up. So you're always rubbing your leg and... You always, when I say get clipped, it's not like you're getting whacked in the head. I mean, we're not in the UFC. Right. these are people that are really getting, we're just getting little tweaks and strains and silly stuff, you know?
Do you watch fighting? Do you like fighting?
Yeah.
You do? You enjoy watching?
It's my favorite thing.
Boxing or UFC?
UFC, actually.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I've always been a fan from day one. It's my favorite sport. It's all I watch, really.
Did you ever train martial arts?
Yeah.
What'd you take?
I did a little bit of jiu-jitsu, I did a little bit of kickboxing, I've done, pretty much, they're the two most specific, and a lot of the fight training that we do is all sort of related to that. A little bit of judo I did for a while, just, you know, screwed about and fucked about in different things, but never trying to achieve a certain, you know, oh, I need to get my black belt in this. basically what I do is just to try and use and adopt stuff for the, you know, for the work that I do. I'm no plans to get in a ring.
No, you just like doing it though. Like training, it keeps you in shape.
The discipline of it, I think, is great, and I think there's so much to be gained, to be got from doing martial arts. It gets people really sort of focused, and I think it really gives them a purpose. And there's a great community with all kinds of competitive sport, and I would recommend it for anybody.
There's really so much of it that, like, nowadays, young kids are training in that with the intention of, theoretically, I could do this with my life, because now there's so much money in it. It's become this realistic thing. Do you look at it like, oh, my God, if there was that much money in this when I was young, that's what I would be doing?
No, I mean, I don't know what I'd be doing what I was doing. I don't think I could go back and go, oh, that could have been something. I don't know. It's hard to say. But in addition to that, I just think a lot of the people that I've met from the fight world have just been really sort of really comfortable in their own skin. They're Randy Couture, people like that I've met, they just breeds a certain confidence, and I think some of the fighters are just like really cool.
Yeah, it must be nice to know you could beat the shit out of anybody in the room. I've never had that feeling. That must be a comfortable feeling where you have nothing to worry about.
I would assume. I've also never had that feeling.
I don't know.
No. Well, yeah, you're pretty tough.
I don't know, Jason. Look around the room and tell us how it feels.
Yeah, I'd put my money on Jason in this room.
I'll do your hair. We won't fight. I'll just blow dry your hair.
Now, when you have to fight somebody like a guy like The Rock size or his physique, are you ever in a fight scene where you're like, how are they going to make people think that we're going to fight?
And this would be equals.
Yeah, because it's stupid, right?
Well, you know.
But welcome to the movie business.
They keep him in short sleeves. They put you in a jacket. I guess, you know, just to kind of bulk you up a little bit.
But I think in movies and, you know, storytelling, and I think contrast and, like, the insurmountable odds are always what people like. You go, fuck, how's he gonna? There's no way you can fight this guy. And I think people get into that. And if you can try and use some kind of skill and slippery technique that kind of wins the day, or at least sort of nullifies the fight, I think it's really entertaining to watch, because, it's the David and Goliath. I think the bigger the contrast, and the better it looks, I think, you know.
Okay, well, so you like overcoming the odds. Who do you look up to?
Anyone who's above 5'10".
Is there anybody that you like who you kind of idolize?
No, not really idolize. Listen, you get inspired by a lot of people. When I was a kid, my brother used to have posters of Bruce Lee on the wall. I mean, I like all martial arts. A lot of the fighters today I think are really great. Anyone who does anything good, I think, is always an inspiration in music, in sport, whatever it might be.
The Rock.
I think The Rock is a good one to pin the hat on. Yeah.
Yeah, he's a good.
He's an inspiration.
He's managed to avoid all scandal in his life. He has a great career. He does kids movies.
Yeah, he's solid. You know, he does a lot. He does a lot for other people. Like, really beyond the Call of Duty, he really does. He's a great sort of a people person, and he's a big movie star, and people love him, and for the right reasons.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. And even when you're searching for stuff, you're like, oh, he did have a divorce, and then you find out he's got a great relationship with his kids, and his ex-wife is his manager. He's got a great relationship with her, too. There's nobody. Yeah, he's got a company with her. Like, he's the man.
I would never trust my ex to handle my career. Because you know your ex is not always going to guide you in the right. You know, I have exes that would really fuck my life up on purpose.
Is that right?
You should do this. Really? Just walk in and piss on the casting director? Yeah, trust me. That's what they
would sabotage you?
Yeah. Yeah, they really would. So, all right. Well, this is coming out when?
This is next Friday.
Next Friday, do you get nervous? I mean, this—you can't even get nervous at a premiere like this. Like, you have to know this is going to do well.
Hey, look, the movie's great, and they get it right. And people that they test the film, people love this type of film. There's a lot of great characters in it. They do. They spend so much money on the action. The set pieces with the cars. There's not another franchise or movie that I can recall that even gets close to what these guys do. They've got a lot of money. They get a great story to back it up. People really buy into the characters, and they really, they get the. It's like a, It's like having all the ingredients and cooking the right, baking the right pie. They get it right. It's not always the same with other sort of franchises. That's why they, you know, we're at number eight, right?
So, yeah. Well, plus you'll be fine anyway because you're doing Expendables 4 and Spy 2. Is that right?
I don't know what I'm doing next. I have no idea.
That's usually a good sign. If you don't know what you're doing next, it probably means that there's stuff going on.
Yeah, you don't know which film you're doing. I mean, those films are there, but I don't know which one we're shooting next. That's a good problem to have.
Yeah.
I just did a movie about a shark. It's a bit of a cross between, I'd say, Jaws and Jurassic Park. It's about an old...
It's not a bad combination.
Oh, a shark. I think you said a shot. Okay, a shark. Was it a prehistoric shark?
Yeah, yeah. It's turned out really good. I mean, apparently, we don't know until we see it.
What's it called?
It's called Meg.
Meg?
As in Megalodon. Yeah.
Oh. Is it part of that franchise, the Jurassic Park franchise?
No. It's okay. It's for Warner Brothers, so, you know, they know how to make
3D?
Yeah.
Probably.
I love a good 3D. I'm a sucker. I'll watch anything in fucking 3D. Kramer versus Kramer,
really
3D.
Go for the 3D.
You don't like 3D? You don't like 3D?
Not really.
Oh,
I'm always sucking around with the glasses, you know? They bug me.
Then again, why would you? You've lived it in 3D. You were there.
Yeah.
You know, you've seen it in 3D. I love 3D.
I'm not a 3D fan either.
I like it.
I don't. But yeah. But I respect respect your
do
ability
you stand
to
there,
like
you sit there with reaching out into the abyss.
Yes,
right?
But I do think when it's not 3D, so I have an excuse at least when it's 3D. I don't look as stupid.
Nervous tick.
But it's fun. You feel like you're involved with it. Is there a lot of CGI on this? And they're telling us we have to wrap with Jason. But is there a lot of CGI in this, or is this
you mean in the Fate of the Furious?
Yes.
When you
I'm
say
sure some, but
of course there is. I mean, a lot of the things that happen are very dangerous, and you know. The thing that you're fighting against is, you know, is the insurance company going to allow you to, you know, do this little stunt here? Because if it goes wrong, you know, there's $300 million at stake and you know, they have to finish the movie and they can't rub you out of the movie halfway through. So they have to make these really executive, smart decisions on what's safe for you to do and what isn't. So there is a little bit of CG, but what I really admire about these people is they really try and put everything in camera. Spiros is the second unit director and my friend JJ Perry, who we do designed all the fight stuff. We do it all in camera. You know, the CGI element will be just to fill in odd frames here and there and create some of the bigger set pieces. Like there's a set thing with a submarine that comes through the ice. I don't know what's real and what isn't.
Right.
But you know, I know all the stuff I did with The Rock and the fight in the jail. You know, we really try and make it feel authentic and real. And that's really important to us. And I think all of the actors try their best to stick their, you know, stick their piece in with that.
Well, real quick, before speaking of insurance, I've been fascinated about Tom Cruise and I forget which Mission Impossible when he was outside that Burj Khalifa tower.
I saw that, yeah.
He was literally on the outside of the tower, and I'm like, how much does it cost in insurance?
You think that was really him or a
guy? I know it was him. I saw photos from fans who were like on a deck shooting him rehearsing.
But you know, you're in a harness and you're on a wire. I mean, they're pretty safe. It's just you've got to get your nuts around the fact that you're very high. But it's pretty safe.
I guess so, but no, I wouldn't do it.
You wouldn't do it because you don't like heights, right?
Yeah.
Yes, and nobody would want me to do it. They're not interested in putting me in a film like
that. If you put that harness on and we strapped you to the wall there, you wouldn't.
No.
You wouldn't think 2 minutes about it.
Oh, you're right. I would actually do that. And I've actually asked women to put a harness on for different reasons. So thank you.
She's still recovering.
Yes, I am. Yeah, I'm kind of sitting on a little inflatable donut. All right. It's Jason Statham on Instagram, of course. And Fate of the Furious is in theaters next Friday. It's obviously going to be a success, and congratulations, man. You're doing amazing.
Yeah. Thanks, chaps.
Yeah,
thanks
for sure,
talking to you.